Well, welcome to Hawthorne University's Holistic Health and Nutrition webinar series, and thank you so much for attending today's presentation on understanding macronutrient-microbiome interactions, implications for optimizing gut health, with Tom Fabian presenting. Welcome, Tom. You know, I'm just so grateful to have you with us again and presenting for us today.
Well, thanks so much, Paula. It's great to be back again, and this is a topic that I'm very excited to present on today.
All right, terrific. I want everybody to know that I don't want you to miss a thing. So we're recording this and it'll be available for replay on our website in just a few days. We also want you to ask all the questions that you may have, and we'll save questions to the end of the presentation. So I just encourage you to write your questions or your comments in the webinar question panel at any time. And I'm Paula Bartholomew. I'm your host. So I want to get you started with the intro to today's topic and our presenter. In this presentation, the two-way interaction between macronutrients and the microbiome will be discussed with a focus on how this interaction impacts important aspects of intestinal health. The actions of the microbiome on undigested carbohydrates may have beneficial or harmful effects depending on the context. And less well known is the fact that many other dietary components, including proteins, fats, phytochemicals, and micronutrients, can also affect the microbiome in ways that may have a positive or negative effect on health. So we should come away from this presentation with a more comprehensive understanding of how targeted nutritional approaches can be implemented to influence microbiome balance and intestinal health. Tom Fabian is a functional nutrition practitioner, educator, speaker, consultant, and translational science expert. He's a former research scientist with deep translational science expertise in the role of the human biome in health, disease, aging, and health span optimization. As a leading expert in translational applications of microbiome research in integrative health settings, Tom's primary focus is on providing educational resources and consulting services for integrative practitioners and consulting and advisory services for clinical laboratory testing services. On a limited basis, he also works with individual clients to improve gut health and optimize health span. Again, we're really pleased to have you with us, Tom, and when you're ready, I'm going to have you get started.
All right. Well, thanks again, Paula. And again, it's great to be here. And thanks, everyone, for tuning in to listen to the webinar. So this topic, I think, is a really interesting topic because at a high level, of course, we all know that diet has a big impact on the microbiome. And of course, there's been a lot of emphasis on the microbiome in the past few years. But we tend to think of just certain things when it comes to how do we optimize the microbiome, how do we deal with imbalances. And so what I want to dive into in this webinar is really getting at a bit of a deeper level based on all this new research that's been coming out for understanding more specifically how particularly macronutrients can influence the microbiome. And we have to really take the context into account there. So that's something I'm going to be focusing on quite a bit in this webinar. So before we get started, I just want to list a couple of my disclosures as far as some of the other activities that I'm involved in. So I'm currently a clinical science and education consultant for a company called Diagnostic Solutions Laboratory. That company is best known for its GI map gut test, and that's basically a DNA-based stool test. So that's something that will be featured in a little bit of what we're going to be talking about today in a case example. Previously, I've also consulted for other microbiome-related companies such as Viome and Vibrant America. So that's really my area of expertise, as Paul alluded to, is understanding the microbiome and how that influences health, and then how we can work with the microbiome in practice. So I wanted to start off with this quote, and this is a quote that I've used in my presentations a number of times over the years. So this is from a publication several years ago, and I think it really rings true even today. As kind of our starting point. This is a quote by a prominent researcher in the microbiome field, Martin Blaser. And in this publication, he stated, "It's reasonable to propose that the composition of the microbiome and its activities are involved in most, if not all, of the biological processes that constitute human health and disease." So this really just sort of, in a nutshell, summarizes why there's so much attention on the microbiome. But the question is, how does the microbiome influence health specifically? And even more importantly, how can we work with that in practice? So that's really going to be the focus of this webinar. So this schematic here is kind of capturing that next level. in terms of some of the key interactive components that are involved in influencing health versus disease. So of course, we know on the left, we have a representation of diet, and we know that that can influence the microbiome, and that's represented in the middle, and that there's actually a two-way interaction. So diet can influence the microbiome. The microbiome, in turn, can influence dietary components, i.e. it can modify components and then convert them into other forms that can have an impact on health, positive or negative, depending on the context. And then on the right, there's a representation of the digestive tract, which is really important to take into account, not only because that's primarily where the gut microbiome has its influence on health initially, but also digestion and GI physiology, in turn, have a big influence on basically what we consume, and also they have a big influence on the microbiome. So all three of these components are really important and highly interactive in determining the effects of diet on that spectrum of health versus disease. So this is kind of our schematic that I'm going to refer back to throughout the webinar, just as our overall framework. So let's dive in just a little bit deeper. So this is a depiction of the intestinal lining. And so at the top is the lumen. And essentially, this is really depicting where these three components come together physiologically. So you can imagine in the lumen, especially in the small intestine and large intestine, is where food components, of course, are. And then also digestive secretions, other physiological factors related to GI physiology also are important in the lumen. And then, of course, we have microbes. And so microbes, many of them tend to be closely associated with the intestinal layer. So you can see that here. So this is really where everything comes together, is in the mucosa of the intestinal tract. So again, you can imagine that these food components are basically available to the microbes. The microbes can potentially convert these components to products that then have an influence on the local environment in the gut, and then more broadly on our general health. So this is kind of a nice schematic to have in mind for going beyond just sort of that abstract image in the previous slide to how does this actually come together physiologically. So of course, when we think of the influence of food on the microbiome, by and large, we tend to think of fiber as sort of the main factor that influences the microbiome. But we actually want to look more broadly at this, and there's a lot more research that's come out in the last few years illustrating how various components of diet, particularly macronutrients and also micronutrients as well, can have an influence on our health. So as far as food components, of course, there's carbohydrates, various types of carbohydrates, proteins, various types of fats, also the phytochemical component of plants, and then various vitamins and minerals. And then at the other end of the spectrum, of course, are all the processed food components, many of which have been shown to have a negative effect on the microbiome. So we're not really going to dive into that here in this presentation. I'm going to focus mostly on carbohydrates and proteins in terms of what we know about their influence on the microbiome and vice versa. Touch on at the end a little bit about what's known around fats and phytochemicals. But this is a really big topic, and there's a lot that we could go into. So each one of these topics potentially could be a separate webinar topic. There's so much information out there. So in addition to food, the other component we want to focus on that's interactive in this model, of course, is digestion and GI physiology. In particular, when we talk about digestion, referring to the level of stomach acid, pancreatic enzymes, brush border enzymes in the small intestine, all of those are really important for determining the quality and extent of digestion, and also bile, of course. So bile acids are secreted to help with the digestion absorption of fats. So all these components are very important and also have an influence on the microbiome and vice versa. So we'll get into some of that here in a bit. So in terms of the microbes, as I mentioned, they can influence stomach acid. Certain microbes opportunists, in particular, in certain pathogens may have an influence on stomach acid, such as H. pylori. Some of them actually also can influence enzyme activity, particularly in the small intestine. So if a particular type of microbe or an overall imbalance, dysbiosis, happens to be present in that area, that is something that can cause, for example, inflammation that can then have a negative effect on brush border enzymes. So we'll talk about that a bit more as well. Microbes also can produce their own enzymes and secrete particularly proteases and also enzymes that break down carbohydrates. So they really can influence and shape the extent of digestion of macronutrients as well. So they tend to sort of complement our own digestive enzyme capacity. Then there's a whole range of microbial metabolic products that they produce from macronutrients in particular. And that's especially important for how they have an influence on our health. So again, this kind of brings us back to the model where all three of these components, foods, microbes, and microbes include both the normal commensal microbes as well as pathogens, can all have an influence. And then also GI physiology and digestion, again, influencing spectrum of health versus disease. So let's go ahead and dive into this first category, carbohydrates, and talk a little bit more about that. So as far as the relationship of carbohydrates in the microbiome, we know that they're the primary source of energy for most gut microbes. Most beneficial microbes can break down carbohydrates, and they're technically referred to as saccharolytic. Some actually don't process carbohydrates or use carbohydrates directly. So they're generally referred to as asaccharolytic. A subset of those primarily subsist on protein or amino acids, and so they're referred to as proteolytic. So they basically produce enzymes that can help break down proteins. That can be very important in terms of this sort of differentiation between positive effects and negative effects. And then microbes also produce a really wide range of carbohydrate digesting enzymes, a much larger list of enzymes than humans do. So humans really only produce sort of a handful of carbohydrate digesting enzymes, whereas microbes potentially can produce hundreds of them. So they can break down many different types of carbohydrates, lots of different types of fibers, et cetera. So that's why they're really complementary in terms of helping to digest certain types of foods that we are not able to. So I just want to focus a little bit on some of the key products of carbohydrate fermentation. And carbohydrate fermentation is the process whereby microbes break down carbohydrates and then generate these products. So at the top of the list are the short-chain fatty acids. I'm sure most of you have already heard about them. The main short-chain fatty acids are acetate, propionate, and butyrate. And so those have really important health effects. And so we'll focus on that a little bit here shortly. They also can produce a wide range of other organic acids and other compounds from carbohydrates. Some of the other ones include lactate, succinate, formate, as well as ethanol. And I'll talk about an interesting case that just came out in research recently regarding that. They also can produce a wide range of gases, particularly hydrogen, methane, and carbon dioxide. And of course, that can have certain symptomatic effects as well. So this is a nice sort of summary of these implications of these products that the microbiome produces from carbohydrates and in particular fiber. So I just want to read this excerpt from this review article, which is titled Gut Microbiome, Profound Implications for Diet and Disease. So they say diverse populations of intestinal bacteria mediate their beneficial effects through the fermentation of dietary fiber to produce short-chain fatty acids, endogenous signals with important roles in lipid homeostasis and reducing inflammation. So they're talking about basically this conversion, but also alluding to some of the key health benefits of short-chain fatty acids in promoting homeostasis of lipids as well as reducing inflammation. This is another review article talking a bit more about the benefits of short-chain fatty acids. So the title here is Short-Chain Fatty Acids in Control of Body Weight and Insulin Sensitivity. And they say short-chain fatty acids can beneficially modulate adipose tissue, skeletal muscle, and liver tissue function. As a result, the short-chain fatty acids contribute to improved glucose homeostasis and insulin sensitivity. So there's a lot of research around the benefits of short-chain fatty acids in relation to counteracting inflammation, promoting metabolic health, et cetera. So really, really important for overall health. I just want to talk about a few other studies here relating to short-chain fatty acids. So this is basically a study where I'm going to be talking about a table from this article in the next slide here. So I just want to show you the reference here. But I want to emphasize the title here, which is the potential of gut commensals in reinforcing intestinal barrier function and alleviating inflammation. So again, these are two major beneficial functions that bacteria tend in the gut tend to promote And it's largely through, again, the production of short-chain fatty acids. This is a figure, it's hard to read the detail here, so I'll go through a kind of a quick summary. But at the top, you can see microbial fermentation and production of short-chain fatty acids. And then there is a box for each of the main short-chain fatty acids. So we have propionate on the left, butyrate, and then acetate. Again, that text is too small and too detailed for us to go through, but basically you can summarize these benefits of short-chain fatty acids, again, as promoting a healthy intestinal barrier, reducing or limiting inflammation, and also promoting metabolic health. So again, that's really the key things to remember when you're thinking about benefits of the good bacteria in the gut, and in particular, the benefits of what they're doing in converting fiber to these various products, especially short-chain fatty acids. So you can imagine if there's a deficiency in fiber or beneficial bacteria, then these three areas may be compromised, and that, of course, can have various health effects. So this is a figure from a review article that gets into a little bit more detail. So it's kind of a nice schematic just to show you more specifically some of these key functions. So on the left, we see that basically commensal microbes can convert fiber from plant foods into short-chain fatty acids, and that's depicted in the middle. Then at the top, we can see that there are several benefits in the mucosa that are depicted, including stimulation of mucus production. So mucus is very protective of the epithelial layer, so it's really an essential component of the barrier. And again, fiber, through the production of short-chain fatty acids, promotes mucus production. Also promotes secretory IgA production, which is very important also for not only protecting against pathogens, but also promoting beneficial bacteria at the same time. Also important for overall epithelial regeneration. So we know that the epithelia tends to regenerate every 3 to 5 days or so. So this plays a really important role in overall tissue regeneration and repair in the gut. And at the bottom, we have a depiction of a few of the additional immune effects of short-chain fatty acids. So you can see on the left here, an example is that it promotes what are called Treg cells. So those are anti-inflammatory immune cells that also promote immune tolerance, which is important for helping to protect against autoimmunity and also help to protect against food allergies, for example. Then generally, they also tend to inhibit inflammation through influencing the expression and activity of the particular pro-inflammatory factor called NF-kappa-B. So just a few examples of some of the details that these short-chain fatty acids act through in order to promote mucosal health. So this is just kind of a side note here, a quick example from a study that just came out in the last couple of months or so that was in a lot of the health news sites. So basically, they found a particular microbe that's often present in the gut called Klebsiella pneumoniae that basically contributes to fatty liver disease through the production of alcohol. So it produces ethanol, and that's one of the products I mentioned that certain bacteria can produce from carbohydrates. So this would be an example of a scenario where, of course, that may not be a very healthy scenario. So some of these products from carbohydrates may have a negative effect depending on the context, but by and large, the products from carbohydrate fermentation are generally thought to be beneficial, except, of course, in excess or in cases where they may be deficient as well. So another thing I want to kind of emphasize here is one of the things that we don't tend to think about as much is when we're thinking about the influence of diet on the microbiome, it's really important to think about the context and sort of where in the GI tract we're talking about, because different parts of the GI tract may have exposure to different nutrients, depending on sort of where that part of the GI tract is in relation to the process of digestion. And also we know that physiological conditions are going to be varying quite a bit depending on where you're talking about in the GI tract. In addition, the microbes will be quite different as well. So in the small intestine, that's of course where digestion absorption primarily take place. And that tends to be, as long as digestion is working as it should, there's a large availability of simple carbohydrates when the complex carbohydrates are broken down. So microbes that do thrive in those areas of the small intestine tend to break down simple carbohydrates, sugars, and then break down products of starches and simple carbs. In the large intestine, that's sort of where the residual carbohydrates that weren't broken down or can't be broken down by human enzymes, those are broken down by these microbial enzymes. So that tends to be, of course, where we think of fiber being important and other types of resistant carbs like resistant starch. So again, it's really important to sort of start differentiating when we're talking about the effects of diet on the microbiome, where we're talking about. Just a little bit more about the microbiome and in relation to the overall digestive tract. One of the big differentiators is the concentration of microbes in different areas, and that has a lot to do with the overall physiology of the different parts of the GI tract. So this is a figure showing the density of microbes in the different parts of the GI tract. So you can see over here on the left, the upper left, this first number is pointing to the stomach, where the numbers are fairly low. You'll see 10 to the power of 1 up to 10 to the power of 3. So basically 10 to 1,000 on average bacterial cells per mil of digestive fluid. So that number tends to continue to stay low in the upper part of the small intestine. So again, these numbers are fairly low, but there is a well-described microbiome in those areas, and that microbiome can have an influence on the functions in that area. Then as you go through the small intestine, and as you get more towards the latter part of the ileum, so towards the terminal ileum, those numbers start to go up dramatically. Now you can see 10 to the power of 4, 10 to the power of 7, so many orders of magnitude higher than in the upper parts of the GI tract. Then when you transition to the colon, those numbers are even higher still, very, very high numbers. You can see 10 to the power of 10 up to 10 to the 13th. So really, really concentrated amounts of microbes in the large intestine. And a lot of that has to do with the nutrients that are available, the physiological factors such as whether it's an anaerobic environment like the colon or more aerobic environment like the upper GI tract, and also motility. So we know that motility is much slower, transit is much slower in the colon, and so that's going to allow time for microbes to process the food more and also grow to a higher concentration. All right, so this is kind of a summary of some of the key physiological factors in general that influence the microbes that can grow in a particular area, and also how that may affect their metabolism of various food components, and then how that can affect health. So it's important to understand this to a certain level. And these key factors include the nutrients that are available, as we've talked about. Again, more simple nutrients are available to microbes higher up. The complex fibers tend to be available lower down. Also the extent of digestion absorption. We know in a lot of patients and clients these days, they tend to have a lot of GI symptoms that reflect issues with digestive capacity and or their ability to absorb. And so that's going to affect the microbiome as well. And we'll see an example of that when we discuss a case later on. Motility, as I talked about, can have a big influence. The immune system has a big presence in the gut, so immune factors can certainly play a big role. Bile acids also play a big role as well in many ways. We know, for example, in the small intestine, generally bile acids tend to have an antimicrobial effect, and so that's one of the factors that keeps the overall numbers of microbes lower in the small intestine. pH and oxygen levels vary throughout the gut as well. That's a big differentiator. And also gut infections and inflammation. And inflammation, of course, can be caused by the infections or from other processes, but those two also have a pretty significant impact on the physiology. So let's go ahead and dive into example of nutrients and how that can affect the microbiome. So this is a recent study that came out. It's a bit controversial because it has to do with calling into question some of the assumptions about SIBO. The title here is Small Intestinal Microbial Dysbiosis Underlies Symptoms Associated with Functional Gastrointestinal Disorders. And they say small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, or SIBO, has been implicated in symptoms associated with functional gastrointestinal disorders, or FGIDs. Here we show that SIBO does not correspond with patient symptoms and may be a result of dietary preferences, whereas on the other hand, small intestinal microbial composition is significantly altered in symptomatic patients. So this may seem like a little bit of a subtle difference in terms of what's the difference between small intestinal dysbiosis versus small intestinal overgrowth, but overgrowth technically is that. It's actually defined by a certain sort of benchmark or level over which the total microbes in the small intestine constitute SIBO, whereas dysbiosis really just has to refer to the imbalance in the microbiome, which might include overgrowth of certain species, but may also include lack of others. So it also can include issues with overall microbial diversity. So again, a really important, interesting study that suggests that actually the imbalances in the small intestine in terms of the microbes may actually be more related to symptoms than general overgrowth. They go on to say that in a pilot interventional study, we found that switching from a high fiber diet to a low fiber, high simple sugar diet triggered functional gastrointestinal disorders, related symptoms, and increased small intestinal microbial diversity, or decreased small intestinal microbial diversity, while increasing small intestinal permeability. So again, this is illustrating that certainly diet alone can have a big effect. So you can imagine, of course, we all know that high sugar diets can have negative effects. One of the mechanisms where that can be problematic is through causing dysbiosis in the small intestine. And that can often lead to symptoms. They go on to say that our findings demonstrate that characterizing small intestinal microbiomes in patients with GI symptoms may allow a more targeted antibacterial or diet-based approach to treatment. So this is a theme we're actually going to focus on through the rest of the webinar here, is that really the details, now that we have the ability to get more detail about what's going on in the GI tract with regard to the microbiome and how that can relate to diet, that can really give us some additional insights into how what's specifically going on with a particular client or patient, and then how that can be more effectively addressed by having that information at our hands. Okay, so the next set of factors that I want to talk about in terms of these physiological factors that influence microbial balance is digestion and absorption. So this study speaks to one aspect of that, and the study is titled Clinical and Histopathologic Predictors of Disaccharidase Deficiency in Duodenal Biopsy Specimens. They say carbohydrate malabsorption, secondary to disaccharidase deficiency, classically results in osmotic diarrhea from increased interluminal osmotic load, but symptoms related to bacterial metabolism of undigested disaccharides can also manifest, including bloating, abdominal pain, and flatulence. So obviously those are very common symptoms that we often attribute to SIBO, for example, but may be specifically due to maldigestion, malabsorption, due to reduced disaccharidase activity. They go on to say disaccharidases are located in the duodenal and proximal jejunal brush border, a site sensitive to mucosal injury. So that's really kind of emerging in research as kind of a hot spot where things can go wrong and where that can contribute to dysbiosis. And then that dysbiosis can go on to relate to a wide range of symptoms and possibly various diseases and conditions. So again, it's important to take these sorts of things into account beyond just considering the diet composition itself. So this is a table from a recent review paper on celiac disease, and they're basically going through and listing other common or known causes of the same type of pathology that's seen in celiac disease. And the idea is that just that typical pathology that's seen in the small intestine could be due to other things. But the main point here is that there are many different factors that can actually impact the function of the small intestine and therefore could lead to impacts on digestion and absorption. So the title of this figure is Causes of Small Intestinal Villus Atrophy. And you can see on the left, there's various immune disorders, immune deficiencies, a variety of infections, even nutritional deficiencies that can all cause small intestinal dysfunction. On the right, there's ongoing factors in the list. So there's malignancies, as well as other factors. They list kind of a random mix here that include various types of drugs, including NSAIDs. So there's a lot of research on NSAIDs in terms of their effects, their negative effects on the small intestine, as well as various types of food allergies, and then also SIBO itself. So all of these can potentially have a big impact on digestion absorption in the small intestine. So in particular, if you think about the brush border enzymes, and so the best characterized ones are the disaccharidases that we talked about, that break down, kind of carry out the last steps of carbohydrate digestion, which allows absorption of those sugars. And then there's also the peptidases, which carry out the last steps in protein digestion. There's also diamine oxidase, which breaks down histamine. Of course, that can potentially be important for patients that may be experiencing histamine intolerance. Then there's intestinal alkaline phosphatase, which is an enzyme that's not really well known as far as its effects in the gut, but it's something that a lot of new research has been coming out in the last few years showing that it actually does several things, but one of the main things is it helps to control dysbiosis and also control the inflammatory response to dysbiosis. And it does that by essentially what's referred to as detoxifying LPS. So we know that a lot of the not so good sort of dysbiotic types of bacteria produce LPS, and that LPS can stimulate inflammation. So this enzyme is really important for helping to reduce the potential for inflammation. So as you can imagine, based on that list that we saw on the previous page, that there are many different things that can affect the brush border enzymes. And so all of these functions may be compromised when the small intestine is not as healthy as it should be. So lastly, I want to talk about infections and inflammation a little bit and their overall influence on microbial imbalance. So just going back to this table that we looked at earlier, just zeroing in on this section. So the infections that are highlighted here include H. pylori, which is pretty common, Giardiasis, and also Cryptosporidia. So there are a number of different types of pathogens that can affect the small intestine. Of course, not all gut pathogens affect the small intestine, but there certainly is a subset that do, and they potentially can cause pathology in the small intestine and then can interfere with digestion and absorption. So this is a study that's talking a little bit more about the effects of H. pylori, and the title is Crypt Hyperplastic Enteropathy in Distal Duodenum in H. pylori Infection, Report of 2 Cases Without Evidence of Celiac Disease. So H. pylori is recognized as one of the most common bacterial infections worldwide and is associated with significant upper GI tract pathology, mainly gastric-related, which is what we normally think of, but also in the duodenum. So again, it can affect the function of the small intestine. And as you can imagine, if it's affecting both the stomach and the small intestine, there can be a twofold impact on digestion, partly through causing hypochlorhydria, which is one of the consequences of H. pylori infection in the stomach, but also it may compromise the activity of the small intestinal brush border enzymes. So we actually do see this quite often clinically. And the case that I'll be talking about later on actually does feature a pattern that we often see in H. pylori infection. So this is an article that discusses the effects of Giardia, and the title is Pathophysiology of Enteric Infections with Giardia duodenalis. So in their summary, they say findings available to date indicate that the infection causes diarrhea by a combination of intestinal malabsorption and hypersecretion. Malabsorption and maldigestion mainly result from a diffuse shortening of epithelial microvilli. This enteric or enterocytic injury is mediated by activated host T lymphocytes. And so basically those are inflammatory cells, so it's mediated by inflammation. Pathophysiological activation of lymphocytes is secondary to Giardia-induced disruption of epithelial tight junctions, which in turn increases intestinal permeability. So basically what they're saying here is that Giardia seems to cause a lot of its negative effects through negative effects on the epithelial microvilli, as well as intestinal permeability, and all of that tends to enhance malabsorption and maldigestion. And basically, the effect of Giardia can mimic celiac disease. So that's kind of the point of this report here. And basically, they say, so the title is Improving Basic Skills in Celiac-Like Disease Diagnosis, a Case Report. And their conclusion is, this case report shows how celiac disease diagnosis can sometimes be manifold. Intestinal villus atrophy alone may not automatically establish a diagnosis of celiac disease. In the present case, the clinical scenario could be fully explained by Giardiasis. So again, this is really emphasizing that some of these opportunists and pathogens can really have a big impact on digestion in ways that actually mimic certain diseases, such as celiac disease. And of course, all of this is going to have an influence on the effects of diet on health. So they're really kind of a key thing to understand, and something that we fortunately can assess in gut testing to give us some information on what's going on so that we have a way to better target how we treat patients and clients. So this is just another article addressing the effects of Giardia. I just really want to emphasize the title here because it pretty much says the key point, which is that Giardia also alters commensal microbial diversity. This was a mouse study, so it's throughout the mouse gut. So it basically shows that Giardia causes extensive dysbiosis. And other research shows that that dysbiosis itself also causes further problems. And we're going to be talking about some of those potential issues with dysbiosis in the gut in the coming slides. So that's one of the examples is here, and the title is Duodenal Microbiota Composition of Adult Celiac Disease Patients is Associated with the Clinical Manifestation of the Disease. So we'll go through a specific example of that in a little bit. But basically this is just discussing the fact that dysbiosis in the upper small intestine actually influences the manifestation of this particular disease. So again, once again, very important to take into account in terms of understanding how diet can influence health outcomes. So again, this is kind of going back to our schematic illustrating the influence of the microbiome on diet components, as well as the role of particularly digestion, overall digestive physiology, but particularly digestion. So I just want to go into a little bit more example here of proteins. So we talked about carbohydrates, so now I want to talk a little bit more about proteins. So as you can imagine, the small intestine, that there are these digestive components, of course, that are coming through and are starting to be digested. And of course, that includes proteins as well. And proteins, of course, are the main source of potential food antigens that individuals could react to, such as gluten, but many other types of foods as well. Whereas in the large intestine, proteins present a different issue related to something called protein fermentation. So two different scenarios relating to protein digestion that I want to talk about a bit here. So this article addresses this first part of what happens in the small intestine. So this says mechanisms by which gut microorganisms influence food sensitivities. They say in the article that one mechanism through which bacteria could affect immune responses to dietary components is through bacterial metabolism of antigens. Indeed, depending on the type of bacteria present, the end result will be increased or reduced immunogenicity of the produced peptides. So this is really referring to the fact that the microbiome in the small intestine actually can influence whether or not these proteins that are potentially antigenic will actually cause a problem in one person or not cause a problem in another due to differences in their microbiome. So we actually know some of the details now, particularly related to gluten, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. But they go on to say, indeed, depending on the type of bacteria present, the end result will be increased or reduced immunogenicity of the produced peptides. So this next article is titled Crosstalk Between Gluten, Intestinal Microbiota, and the Intestinal Mucosa in Celiac Disease, Recent Advances and Basis of Autoimmunity. So this is where they started to identify some of these particular microbes that seem to exacerbate or improve whether or not, or influence whether or not an individual will experience symptoms in celiac disease. So in this case, they say Pseudomonas aeruginosa, isolated from celiac disease patients, cleaved, i.e. broke down, gluten peptides in such a manner that it activated gluten-specific T cells in celiac disease patients. So basically, Pseudomonas can break down these gluten peptides from the gluten proteins in a way that basically is more stimulating to the inflammatory cells and can exacerbate symptoms. They go on to say, on the other hand, lactobacillus species isolated from non-celiac disease controls had potential to reduce the immunogenicity of the peptides produced by Pseudomonas aeruginosa. So of course, in individuals that have a higher lactobacillus presence, and particularly certain species, may be able to counteract this effect of Pseudomonas aeruginosa. So this is really getting into the details of this balance in the microbiome and how that's going to influence the response to particular dietary components, in this case, gluten. So really important, really interesting information. Along those lines, there's more research on other beneficial bacteria. So just going to read the title here, because again, this sort of emphasizes the main point from the study, which is a commensal Bifidobacterium longum strain prevents gluten-related immunopathology in mice through expression of a serine protease inhibitor. So this is basically through a somewhat different mechanism, which you don't need to get into. But basically, this is talking about how yet another example of a beneficial bacterium that's often available in probiotics can actually help reduce the gluten-related immunopathology. So again, it really comes down to the balance, and then how do we influence that balance to reduce the reactivity to various potential food antigens. So the take home from all this so far that we've been talking about in the last few slides is that gut microbes can influence the development of food sensitivities, food reactions that include allergies and intolerances as well. So this is a really interesting result that's been coming out of research in the last few years. The good news is that this suggests that we have ways to potentially influence this by influencing the gut microbiome. And of course, we can do that partially through influencing diet. So again, this is just sort of illustrating when it comes to proteins. Again, we're thinking about small intestine versus large intestine. So in the small intestine, that was a scenario that we just talked about where the presence of microbes in the small intestine can modify whether or not certain food proteins are antigenic or not in certain individuals based on the microbiome makeup. But in the large intestine, there's a different potential situation that's basically suggested by protein in the colon, and that's protein fermentation. Oops. So this is a review article discussing this in a bit more detail. The title here is Microbial Fermentation of Dietary Protein, an Important Factor in Diet-Microbe-Host Interaction. So they say a review of recent studies suggests an important role for microbial protein fermentation in altering the gut microbiota and generating a diverse range of bioactive molecules which exert wide-ranging host effects. These metabolic products have been shown to increase inflammatory response, tissue permeability, and colitis severity in the gut. So sort of contrary to the products of carbohydrate fermentation, which are mostly viewed as beneficial, fermentation of dietary-related proteins can, especially if it's excessive, result in a range of potentially negative products. They go on to say they are also implicated in the development of metabolic disease, including obesity, diabetes, and non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Specific products of proteolytic fermentation, such as hydrogen sulfide, ammonia, and something called p-cresol, may also contribute to the development of colorectal cancer. So definitely a process that we want to be aware of, and there are certain ways that we may be able to reduce overall levels of protein fermentation. So we'll talk about that as well. This is just a depiction from that same article. So on the left, you can see when there is high levels of protein fermentation, you can get all these various products produced that at certain levels are not necessarily harmful. And a lot of these actually are used by other bacteria for their own metabolism. So essentially, a lot of the bacteria tend to detoxify these. But if this is produced in excess, that's where it really can be problematic. And it can lead to inflammation and then cell proliferation, which is something that may be involved in promoting cancer. Versus the opposite, fiber fermentation, so in other words, carbohydrate fermentation, tends to block this process or reduce this process. So they tend to have an antagonistic relationship. This is another article that emphasizes some of the aspects of protein fermentation. So the title here is Insights into Colonic Protein Fermentation, Its Modulation and Potential Health Implications. They say high protein, reduced carbohydrate diets alter the colonic microbiome, favoring a potentially pathogenic and pro-inflammatory microbiota profile, decreased short-chain fatty acid production, and increased ammonia, phenols, and hydrogen sulfide concentrations. And they go on to say increased protein fermentation as a result of a high protein intake can be attenuated by addition of oligosaccharides, resistant starch, and non-starch polysaccharides, as well as, of course, a reduction in total protein. So this is really interesting information in terms of kind of getting back to how do we influence these processes that can impact health once we understand what processes tend to be beneficial, which ones tend to be more negative, and then what can we do about it? So this is basically, again, referring to the fact that protein fermentation and carbohydrate fermentation tend to be sort of antagonistic to one another. And then basically by increasing particularly fiber intake and other types of resistant carbohydrates, you can counteract or reduce protein fermentation. So this is giving you a little bit more of a detailed picture of what this looks like from sort of the anatomical perspective. So when we're focusing in on the large intestine, so on the left is the ascending colon, that's where on average most of the carbohydrate fermentation tends to be most prevalent, versus as that process tends to sort of become depleted through the rest of the colon, then there's typically an increase in protein fermentation. So it's thought that the more fiber that's consumed, the more resistant carbohydrates that are consumed, that carbohydrate fermentation can extend further throughout the colon and help reduce the extent of protein fermentation. But this is just an important thing to understand. And it's thought to be, for example, one of the reasons why colon cancer and ulcerative colitis are more prevalent in the descending colon. So basically on the right-hand side, because those processes may be promoted by excessive protein fermentation. So this is a schematic just kind of showing what I just talked about, which is basically this antagonistic relationship between dietary carbs and protein fermentation, going from the proximal colon in the left to the distal colon on the right. So on average, in a relatively healthy scenario, carbohydrate fermentation tends to predominate, and you'll have carbohydrate fermentation occurring throughout almost the entire length of the large intestine, with protein fermentation still increasing to some extent, but being counteracted by the carbohydrate fermentation. Versus in a less healthy situation where there's, for example, any diet that doesn't contain enough fiber, or it's potentially a very high protein diet, or even an individual that may not digest protein very well, that can lead to an excess of protein in the colon and a deficiency of carbohydrate fermentation. And that's where that scenario can be more problematic and may promote certain disease processes. All right, so now I just want to kind of dive in a little bit. We talked mostly about carbohydrates and proteins. Those are the best studied macronutrients in relation to their effects on the microbiome and vice versa. We certainly know this a lot about this well-established sort of antagonistic relationship. So the question is, what about the other macronutrient category, i.e. fats? So I'm just going to talk about this category just a little bit here. There is a lot more information to potentially cover, but again, that would be more information that we can include in this particular webinar. So as far as the fats that have been studied more extensively, they tend to be the omega-3 fatty acids, saturated fatty acids, and then also bile acids, which of course largely are produced in response to the content of fat in the diet. And it turns out those also have well-established effects on the microbiome and also gut health. So I'm just going to show a few kind of sample studies here. I'm not going to really go into the details, but just to give you kind of a sense of some of this research and what it seems to be showing. So on this slide here, we've emphasized several different studies that have to do with the effects of saturated fats. And so this first study is titled Saturated Fatty Acids Trigger TLR4-Mediated Inflammatory Response. So just a side note is that TLR4 is actually the receptor for lipopolysaccharide, or LPS. So that's, of course, one of the key inflammatory products from certain microbes in the microbiome. So we know that basically they can stimulate inflammation through the fact that LPS can activate this receptor, which initiates inflammatory responses. Well, it turns out that saturated fatty acids can essentially trigger that same receptor. So it has saturated fatty acids can have the same effects in some ways as LPS itself. The next study is titled Western Diet Induces Colonic, something called nitrogic myenteric neuropathy. So basically causes neuropathy and dysmotility in mice via saturated fatty acid and LPS-induced TLR4 signaling. So basically saying something very similar, but also including the fact that it's been shown saturated fatty acids and LPS that induce inflammation have also been shown to cause neuropathy and dysmotility. And then the last study here is mechanisms for the activation of toll-like receptor 2 and 4 by saturated fatty acids and inhibition by DHA. So that's one of the omega-3 fatty acids. So That can actually be counteracted to a large extent by omega-3 fatty acids. So there's a few more studies here addressing the effects of omega-3s in the gut. This first one is titled Omega-3 Fatty Acids, Polyunsaturated Fatty Acids, An Innovative Strategy Against Obesity and Related Metabolic Disorders, Intestinal Alteration and Gut Microbiota Dysbiosis. So again, another study supporting the beneficial effects of omega-3s in the gut and in particularly on the microbiome. The next study is titled Maternal Omega-3 Fatty Acids Regulate Offspring Obesity Through Persistent Modulation of Gut Microbiota. So that's very interesting that omega-3 fatty acid intake in mothers can actually have a beneficial effect on their children in terms of promoting a healthy microbiome. The next one is titled Fish Oil is More Potent Than Flaxseed Oil in Modulating Gut Microbiota and Reducing Something Called TMAO, Exacerbated Atherogenesis. So once again, fish oil, we know that that can promote cardiovascular health, and it appears that part of that effect is through modulating the gut microbiome. Lastly, there's a study here featured on olive oil. And so it's the title is The Effects of Olive Oil and Its Minor Components on Cardiovascular Diseases, Inflammation, and Gut Microbiota. And essentially what they showed in this particular study is that components of olive oil, which include certain polyphenols as well, have beneficial effects on the microbiome, also can reduce inflammation, and also can reduce metrics or measures of cardiovascular disease. So again, there's kind of this balance of fats that may have a negative effect on the microbiome and therefore negative effects on health, and then other types of fats that can promote a healthy microbiome. So this basically is a review article that discusses a little bit about what's known about the effects of bile acids on the microbiome and also in relation to health. So it turns out that some of the best studied effects of fats on the microbiome have to do with these bile acids that fats in the diet tend to stimulate. So I'm just going to go through the last points here in their summary. They say, looks like I forgot to highlight the line above it, but basically they say bile acids can modulate gut microbiota composition both directly and indirectly through activation of innate immune genes in the small intestine. Thus, host metabolism can be affected through microbial modifications of bile acids, which lead to altered signaling via bile acid receptors, but also by altered microbiota composition. So a lot of information here, but the bottom line is that basically the bile acids that are released as part of digestion do have an influence on the microbiome, as well as also directly on health, particularly metabolic health and also on immune function, and that the microbiome can actually modify that in ways that are beneficial or not beneficial, depending on the types of microbes that are present. So yet another way in which fats can influence the microbiome and also can influence health. This is a very interesting recent study that came out just in the last year that talks a little bit about the effects of the ketogenic diet on the microbiome and on health. So basically, I'm just going to read their summary here on the right. So they say the beneficial effects of a ketogenic diet on epileptic seizures are mediated by the gut microbiome through the modulation of hippocampal GABA glutamate ratios. So this is obviously another sort of aspect of looking at the effects of fat on the microbiome and on health. So we know there's a lot of research on the ketogenic diet and a lot of the beneficial effects. So it turns out, of course, ketogenic diets have been used for a long time as a way to help address epilepsy. And it turns out that there's now evidence suggesting that some of that effect of the ketogenic diet is through effects on the microbiome, and that the microbiome can then have effects on the neurotransmitter balance in the brain. So really, really interesting study. But again, it's sort of emphasizing that all these macronutrient components can have significant effects on the microbiome and, of course, then on health. I'm just going to touch on here a little bit on phytochemicals. That's actually another potentially really large topic that could be an entire webinar in and of itself. But basically, phytochemicals have a lot of well-described effects on the microbiome, and many of their effects on health are dependent on modifications by the microbiome of these phytochemicals. So again, they're components that are present in a wide variety of fruits and vegetables. We tend to think of them as the ones that give fruits and vegetables their colors. And really, there's been large number of studies on their health benefits. We tend to think of them, for example, as anti-inflammatory as well as antioxidants. But a lot of these beneficial effects are mediated through the gut microbiome. So this is just a quick review, quick excerpt from a review article titled "The Reciprocal Interactions Between Polyphenols and Gut Microbiota and Effects on Bioaccessibility." So they say polyphenols modulate the composition of the gut microbial community, mostly through inhibiting pathogenic bacteria and stimulating beneficial bacteria. In the latter, they may act as prebiotic metabolites and enrich the beneficial bacteria. So it's kind of just a summary conclusion from all the studies that are out there suggesting that, kind of in a way that's similar to prebiotics, that they tend to promote beneficial bacteria and inhibit pathogenic bacteria. So of course, as you can imagine, polyphenols are a really important tool to understand in terms of how we can use them to help beneficially modulate the microbiome. Okay, so that's a lot of information related to the effects of macronutrients on the microbiome, the role of digestion, et cetera. So now I want to kind of bring a lot of this information together and illustrate it through a case example. So this is, just going to go through something really quick here, not get into the details, but basically this is a 46-year-old female who has been experiencing chronic constipation and fatigue, as well as a lot of food sensitivities. And then the reactions include headaches, skin rashes, as well as a range of other symptoms. So clearly some digestive dysfunction happening, as well as lots of food sensitivities and then related systemic symptoms to that. So on the gut test, and this is the GMAP gut test, we see in the pathogen section that C. difficile toxins are detected at high levels. So obviously the pathogenic strains of C. diff are present at a high level. So that, of course, may be something that may be impacting the health of the gut. Although, as we saw in the patient case description, normally you would think of an outright C. diff infection as causing diarrhea or loose stools, but this patient happens to have constipation. So that calls into question, you know, what is the effect that C. diff in this case may be having? The other way we also want to look at this, though, is when there is the presence of pathogens, especially at high levels in patients, we want to not only consider what's the potential effect based on what we know, but also why is that pathogen there? Why is it overgrowing? We have a lot of new research now that indicates some of these physiological imbalances that can actually contribute to a favorable environment for a pathogen. So that's really relevant to this particular case and relevant to what we've been talking about as far as impacts on digestive function. So this is the next section of results, and we can see that there's nothing picked up here, so no parasitic pathogens, no viral pathogens, also no H. pylori in this case. Then there's a normal bacterial flora section, so we can get a sense of whether or not there's general dysbiosis. I did highlight a couple of the species in this section, because they relate to what we've been talking about in terms of beneficial bacteria, particularly Faecalibacterium praesnitzii. That's one of the key species that produces one of the short-chain fatty acids called butyrate. So low levels of Faecalibacterium have been linked to a really broad range of inflammatory and autoimmune conditions. So low levels certainly can be problematic and also can be indicative in general of a potential for low butyrate production. Whereas Akkermansia mucinifera is something that depends on a healthy mucus layer. It depends on mucus as its main fuel source, source of energy. So when that's deficient, that may be an indicator that the mucus layer, the protective mucus layer, may be deficient as well. So generally, if you think back to one of the slides where we're talking about all the different potentially beneficial effects of the short-chain fatty acids and the beneficial bacteria that produce them, a lot of it comes down to promoting a healthy intestinal lining as well as reducing inflammation. So that's really kind of the conclusion here when we start to see evidence of low key beneficial bacteria, probably the intestinal lining is not so healthy. And also there's less of an anti-inflammatory capacity. Certainly we know that low beneficial bacteria also tend to predispose to pathogens. So that may be one of the results that's contributing to the overgrowth of the pathogenic C. diff that we saw on the first screen. This is the section on opportunistic bacteria. We can see that a number of them are elevated. So this is sort of typical of what we consider to be an overgrowth pattern, often related to reduced digestive capacity. Many of these are known to be especially prevalent in the small intestine, such as Pseudomonas. That's the one I've highlighted in the middle. That one in particular has a lot of new research around it, indicating that it can cause inflammation in the duodenum and can predispose to food sensitivities in general, as well as in particular gluten sensitivity. We did see that in the summary for this patient, that one of the main complaints was food sensitivities. So this may be quite relevant to what we see for this patient. Klebsiella is also present. We did see that there was one study that suggests at least some Klebsiella may produce higher levels of ethanol. High levels of ethanol in the gut can also contribute to inflammation, leaky gut. Also just generally tends to be inflammatory. It's one of the species that can produce LPS. So that's something we often see in the more inflammatory type of dysbiosis. In this patient, we didn't see any fungi or yeast, also no viruses, and also no parasites. In terms of the markers for intestinal health, in this section on digestion, we can see that elastase is quite low, and that's basically a marker for pancreatic digestive enzyme production. So I mentioned that the overall pattern that we've seen, especially with the overgrowth of opportunists, is often related to poor digestion. And this is confirming that there does seem to be a significant deficiency in digestion, in this case involving issues with low pancreatic function. I also mentioned that there are some markers indicating some inflammatory dysbiosis. And you can see at the bottom, I've highlighted calprotectin, which is a key marker for inflammation. So in this context here, we have several things that might be contributing to this elevated level of inflammation. We also see just above that, that secretory IgA is elevated. That also is indicating heightened immune reactivity, which is something we often see in patients that are prone to food sensitivities. So we have a scenario here where we have evidence suggesting certain species that can promote food sensitivities. We have a potential pathogen, although it's not producing the classic symptoms, and that is C. diff. So this is a really important area to assess in terms of whether or not these pathogens and opportunists may be having a significant impact in that particular client or patient. So certainly this indicates that C. diff may be having an impact in terms of stimulating inflammation. That is one of the known impacts of C. diff, even if it's not producing the classic symptoms of diarrhea. All right, so just want to kind of summarize this case, and we'll get into a little bit of research that kind of fleshes this out a bit more. So as far as the case summary, again, this patient complains of chronic constipation, fatigue, as well as extensive food sensitivities. We found that C. diff is high on the test. There's also overgrowth of dysbiotic bacteria, including inflammatory bacteria. There's a deficiency of beneficial bacteria, in particular Faecalibacterium, one of the important butyrate-producing bacteria. There's also low elastase, indicating poor digestion, elevated secretory IgA, and high calprotectin, indicating enhanced immune reactivity. So as far as connecting the dots, let's kind of walk through this here. But basically, the reduced digestive capacity and potentially slow motility, since she complained of chronic constipation, contribute to increased protein fermentation. So that's something that's pretty well established from the research, and we see this a lot clinically. So likely she has a scenario where there's an increased level of protein fermentation. This increased protein fermentation then can reduce carbohydrate fermentation from beneficial bacteria. So this increased protein fermentation may be one factor that's leading to a reduction in these beneficial butyrate producers. The next bullet point is reduced protein digestion dysbiosis then contribute to food sensitivities because they can promote, or that's reflected in high secretory IgA, but also low short-chain fatty acids can contribute to food sensitivities since we know that butyrate promotes oral tolerance. And basically when butyrate is low, then that's been shown in research to decrease oral tolerance, i.e. increase the incidence of food sensitivities. The last bullet point here is that C. diff, dysbiosis, and food sensitivities altogether can increase gut inflammation. So that may be why we see calprotectin being so elevated in this patient. So I just want to talk a little bit more about a few research studies that kind of wrap this up a little bit more, connect some more dots. So this is just sort of a general summary paper about proton pump inhibitors and how that relates to C. diff. So they say PPIs or PPI therapy and risk of Clostridium difficile infection, systematic review and meta-analysis. In this study, they say the meta-analysis provides further evidence that PPI use is associated with an increased risk for development of C. diff infection. Further high-quality prospective studies are needed to assess whether this association is causal. We actually do, in fact, see this association quite a bit in the clinic. So basically with tests like the GMAP, where we can see various aspects of gut health, including presence of pathogens like C. diff, we will often see additional evidence that's consistent with low stomach acid. So that can be in patients, for example, that actually are on PPIs, but of course there are other factors that can reduce stomach acid. One of the ones that we highlighted earlier was H. pylori, and that is something we commonly see as being present when C. diff is also present. There's new research that's also showing that C. diff tends to be promoted in terms of its growth and its germination in the gut by low stomach acid. So again, this association between low stomach acid and C. diff infection is pretty well established. And so this pattern that we see of reduced digestion in this patient might be related to low stomach acid, which then also increases the chance that C. diff will overgrow. This next study is titled C. diff uses amino acids associated with gut microbial dysbiosis in a subset of patients with diarrhea. Clostridium species are among the best described users of free amino acids as energy sources. Amino acids have been shown to regulate toxin production in vitro, and recently they have been predicted to support colonization of C. diff in antibiotic-treated mice. So this is relating to the fact that it's actually well established that C. diff and the broader group of bacteria that C. diff is in, which is the Clostridium genus, many of them tend to thrive on amino acids. And so that's one of the reasons why we tend to see them elevated when there's an increase in protein fermentation. So that gives us yet another clue as to what may be going on in this patient and why we see C. diff elevated, because we see evidence of reduced digestion overall, which of course can reduce protein digestion. In that scenario, more protein tends to get into the colon and then can further fuel C. diff growth. They go on to say actually that prophylactic dietary intervention using a low prolines or overall low protein diet in germ-free mice colonized by a dysbiotic human gut microbiota resulted in decreased expansion of C. diff after challenge, suggesting that amino acid availability might be important for C. diff infection. So again, their potential approach here that might translate into a potential approach clinically is by using a lower protein diet to reduce this level of protein fermentation, which then can potentially reduce C. diff. On the other hand, this points to a potential therapeutic approach beyond just reducing protein. So the title here is Microbiota Accessible Carbohydrates Suppress C. diff Infection in a Mouse Model. They say, we demonstrate that, so basically their term for fiber is microbiota accessible carbohydrates, or MAC. So we demonstrate that fiber deficient diets perpetuate C. diff infection. We show that C. diff burdens are suppressed through the addition of either a diet containing a complex mixture of fibers or a simplified diet containing inulin as the sole fiber source. So again, experimental evidence suggesting that this antagonism between carb fermentation and protein fermentation can be used to a potentially beneficial effect. So just going back to our figure here illustrating this sort of antagonistic relationship. So potentially there may be many scenarios where this can come into play beyond just C. diff infection. So it suggests that by improving or enhancing carbohydrate fermentation with fiber, protein fermentation can be decreased, and then that could potentially lead to reduced levels of growth of pathogens like C. diff. So basically, just want to kind of come back around and summarize what would be a typical approach in this scenario for this particular case. So in terms of nutritional support, that comes down to promoting a higher fiber diet, also emphasizing polyphenols. Basically didn't go through the research there, but there's also research showing that polyphenols can reduce protein fermentation, and that fiber and polyphenols together can have a synergistic effect. That basically a diet that's also low in simple carbs and sugar, and also potentially lower in protein may be therapeutic as well to address these sorts of scenarios, as well as an overall anti-inflammatory diet. For this particular patient who experiences a lot of food sensitivities, of course, an elimination diet, at the very least gluten-free, dairy-free may be beneficial. And then emphasizing probiotics and fermented foods, because many of those beneficial bacteria like lactobacillus, bifidobacteria species, may also have beneficial effects in altering particularly food sensitivities by their beneficial effects on counteracting what some of the dysbiotic bacteria are doing. Then in terms of digestive support, pancreatic enzymes, HCL, and bitters can all help support digestive function when there's evidence of reduced digestive capacity. Again, in this particular patient, we saw that they had a general digestive dysfunction microbial pattern along with low elastase. And then also for many patients, it comes down to also addressing gut-brain issues because, of course, the vagus nerve has a very big influence on overall digestive function. Then when there's extensive dysbiosis and also, of course, the presence of pathogens and opportunists may be beneficial to consider an antimicrobial botanical protocol. With certain botanicals that tend to be broader spectrum, and also potentially considering things like Saccharomyces boulardii, as well as immunoglobulins such as colostrum, all of which have been shown to help reduce dysbiotic bacteria and pathogens and promote beneficial bacteria. So that kind of brings us back to our overall figure here, and I hope some of the research I've talked about, as well as this case example, helps to show you that considering dysbiosis kind of in the context of digestive function, digestive physiology, can be very important for understanding the effects of diet and then how you can use that information to target dietary approaches to address specific situations. So again, it goes way beyond just sort of generally emphasizing a higher fiber diet, for example, really can be helpful to understand the details of what's going on. So that brings me to my key summary points here. So I just want to mention a few of them here. So macronutrient types and amounts, of course, have major effects on the microbiome, but also vice versa. Microbiome certainly modify various nutrients and determine their effects on health. And then the second point is diet, microbes, and gastrointestinal function together determine the overall response to these dietary components. So again, you have to kind of consider everything in context. Consider factors that affect the above, such as gut infections, various drugs, particularly things like NSAIDs, antibiotics, proton pump inhibitors, et cetera, that are known to have negative effects on GI function and or the microbiome. A few more key summary points: that excessive simple carb fermentation is known to contribute to a lot of common GI symptoms, and that can be due to either just excessive consumption or to reduced digestion. And in particular, for example, issues in the small intestine that affect the disaccharidase enzymes. So those scenarios are fairly common in terms of links to the common GI symptoms, such as bloating and gas, et cetera. The next point is that insufficient resistant carb intake can exacerbate protein fermentation and inflammation. The last point is excessive protein fermentation can be addressed in several ways. We talked about increasing resistant carbs and fiber, also reducing protein, and also emphasizing improving digestion. So those are all potential ways to reduce protein fermentation. All right, so just want to leave off with some of these last key take-homes. So of course, I hope all this illustrates that context is critical for determining a specific approach. So the more we know about the details of what's going on in the gut, that can certainly help inform our approach. So ideally, that comes down to assessing the state of the microbiome, as well as general gut health, to more effectively target nutrition support. And if you are someone that is able to do or likes to do testing, certainly that can provide some critical information so that you're not necessarily guessing as much as to what might be causing symptoms in a given individual. Well, thank you so much for listening. And my contact information is here. I have courses available on the microbiome through microbiomemastery.com. Also, check out Diagnostic Solutions Lab for more information on the GI map test and some educational materials. And then there's also my Facebook page as well that has some additional information. So again, thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Tom. Just fabulous presentation. I learned so much. Thank you.
It's my pleasure.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's some good questions. But I want to circle back. You know, before we started the webinar, you and I had an opportunity to talk a little bit. And we were talking about the effects of antibiotics and the use of probiotics after using antibiotics, or in some cases, the suggestion of using probiotics while somebody is taking antibiotics. So can you speak to that a little bit?
Absolutely. Yeah, there's some new research that's come out in the last year or two that addresses that to some extent. So far, it's only one study, although it was from one of the major research labs on terms of the microbiome research. So the data is very compelling. But basically what they showed is that even though it's common for clinicians to suggest using probiotics as a way for patients to help their microbiome recover after using antibiotics, this study showed that actually what probiotics may do, at least in some patients, is actually inhibit the recovery of the native beneficial bacteria. So I know a number of clinicians, not necessarily based just on that study, but also based on just other clinical experience, that tend to hold off on using antibiotics until they've done other things to help promote recovery of the beneficial bacteria, which in particular includes making sure that patients or clients are getting plenty of high fiber plant content in their diet. So again, it's that sort of combination of fiber plus polyphenols from those plant foods or from supplements like prebiotics that can be quite beneficial in helping those native bacteria recover, because probiotics may actually compete with some of those beneficial bacteria when the beneficial bacteria are knocked down by antibiotics. So again, it's, you know, we'd like to see more studies on that to really confirm that, but it is suggestive that that may be something to consider in terms of how do you help the microbiome recover after antibiotics.
Wonderful. There's some follow-up questions on various infections. You know, long-term infections, certainly gut infections like Giardia and things like that, you reviewed very well. But if somebody has, you know, Lyme, a case of Lyme disease, for example, and they've been on long-term antibiotics, years of consistent multiple combinations of antibiotics, and it's years later and autoimmune has developed. So it's a escalating scenario of worsening symptoms and health happening here. And how would you address something like that that's so chronic and entrenched and help rebuild after such a situation?
That's a good question. So I think, you know, it always starts with testing to see kind of what you have to work with. So certainly I have seen test results for patients that have been on long-term antibiotics for Lyme disease. And in some ways, it's not as bad as you might expect. I mean, certainly that's not an optimal scenario to be on antibiotics that long from the standpoint of the microbiome. But typically they have plenty of you know, beneficial bacteria still left that they can sort of work with that scenario. So it really comes down to kind of looking at the big picture and, again, promoting beneficial bacteria often comes down to kind of typical things like emphasizing fiber, polyphenols. Now we even know that particularly in the colon, supplementation with butyrate can actually be quite helpful and once again has been shown to be synergistic with beneficial bacteria. And what's interesting is some of the research studies that are out there, and researchers have written articles on this, that because the microbiome naturally can be severely affected by infections, et cetera, that there's actually considered now to be reservoirs, including the appendix and also certain sort of folds in the colon, where beneficial bacteria can still remain despite sort of all these insults to the gut in general. And so you can really start with these small populations potentially, and as long as you restore a healthy gut environment, they can potentially start to repopulate the gut. So I think that provides a lot of hope, you know, when you know that the gut microbiome has really been, you know, severely negatively affected through things like antibiotics long term. There's oftentimes, and another study showed that actually a lot of the beneficial bacteria that produce butyrate actually do form spores. And so now there's research showing that we can actually get them environmentally. So you can actually potentially repopulate them if they're completely gone. There's the potential to essentially kind of recover them from external sources. That's kind of an ongoing thing. That research only came out in the last year. So we don't really know the implications of that yet or whether those would be available as probiotics. But it, really, I think there's a lot of hope in terms of being able to recover to a large extent these beneficial microbes. But again, it's really comes down to knowing these various physiological factors that influence the microbiome, and then if at all possible, doing testing. So you kind of know where you're starting from and what to focus on.
Great. There was a question later, but I'll bring it in right now because we're on testing. I mean, we're talking gut infections, H. pylori, Lyme, things like that, antibiotics. So let's talk testing a little bit. What testing would you do in a situation like that?
That's a good question. So, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of variations out there in terms of microbiome testing. There are some that are clinically focused and only can be ordered by clinicians. And then there are some that are direct to consumer that typically will kind of give you a report on your microbiome that most people can't make too much of because it's it's often just a list of microbes that we don't know much about. But they'll give dietary recommendations. So for clinicians, generally, I would, of course, emphasize going with the more clinically oriented tests because they typically don't necessarily give you a lot of information on the overall microbiome, and many of those microbes that are in the direct-to-consumer type tests, we don't really know much about. So that can potentially be confusing and overwhelming for clinicians trying to figure out what does this mean. Whereas the clinical tests tend to focus on the most clinically relevant microbes, so pathogens, opportunists, and some of the key beneficial bacteria that give us a sense of what's going on with the microbiome as a whole, you know, the ones that we know more about. And also a key differentiator with clinical testing is that they also often include intestinal health markers that give you insights into digestion and immune responses, et cetera. So you can really get a good overall picture of what's going on. And as we just saw in the webinar, you have to understand the intestinal physiology to a large extent to understand the microbiome and vice versa. If you only see one side of that equation, you're not getting the full picture. So definitely clinically oriented testing that's meant for clinicians. I think it's at this stage is still going to be the most useful clinically for clinicians and their patients and clients.
Okay, thanks. I think there's two things here. One is testing the gut health itself. So for example, using GI maps would be a go-to test. But testing the microbiome itself, do you have suggestions on lab for that?
That's a good question. That's kind of an ever-changing scenario. For example, for a long time, Ubiome was sort of the leading company, or at least the most popular company, and then they've suddenly kind of gone offline. That's one I can't really comment too much on because it's kind of a shifting scenario, and it sort of depends on what you're looking for. So there, some of them are kind of getting into more niche areas. Like there's one called, I believe it's called Day 2, that's focused more on assessing the microbiome in terms of its effects on glucose regulation. So that's particularly maybe relevant for people that, of course, have diabetes or metabolic syndrome. So that's kind of one of the directions that that sort of testing is going. But again, my opinion is that direct-to-consumer testing, it can be useful for really well-trained, knowledgeable clinicians that really know the microbiome well. They may be able to pick up certain patterns that are related to, you know, whatever's going on with their patients or clients. But it requires a lot more work typically to make sense of those sorts of tests. So again, I think tests like GIMAP that are really geared towards clinicians and getting you the most clinically relevant information are definitely going to be more useful to most clinicians.
Okay. I've seen a number of clinicians when there's gastric distress and trying to isolate various food and reactions to foods and things like that, will recommend ingesting only one macronutrient at a time at a meal. So isolating it so they're only eating protein at a meal and carbohydrate at another and fat at another. What's your opinion on that approach?
That's a good question. So, you know, In the big picture, as long as they're getting variety, it may not make that much of a difference. I'm not aware of any studies specifically that have looked at that. But if they're just, you know, say they're on the carnivore diet, for example, and literally pretty much just eating meat, you know, there can be, if you look at it narrowly, there may be some health benefits or symptom benefits of that, especially if those patients are just, you know, don't digest carbohydrates very well. Mm-hmm. But in the big picture, we certainly know a lot about microbiome diversity and its relation to health. And it's hard to have a diverse microbiome without a diverse diet. So that's, you know, if one meal is carbohydrates, the next meal is mostly protein, et cetera, that seems like it's a less extreme scenario than just doing, for example, all meat for months on end.
Right.
So, you know, it really does come down, I think, to just promoting diversity in the microbiome. And there's just so much information on the benefits of short chain fatty acids. And even though you can get a low level of those from protein, by and large, they're mostly produced from, of course, the breakdown of fibers. A long term, you know, sort of zero fiber or very low fiber diet, while it might alleviate some symptoms in certain patients that are super sensitive, it's overall probably not good for the microbiome or for long-term health.
But I wonder if having separate meals like that of the one macronutrient at a time, if it would be beneficial in a way that it would help identify if it's more protein fermentation or carb fermentation, as opposed to an imbalance of bacteria.
Right. Yeah. I mean, that's right? An interesting question. It'd be interesting to see if that, you know, bears out, if that's something that, you know, is explored clinically, that could potentially help identify, you know, where they have their most significant issues. Generally though, you know, as we saw when we were kind of looking at that slide on the brush border enzymes, for example, and the small intestine seems to be a bit of a hot spot for digestive issues. Basically, in that compartment, of course, we have disaccharidases and also peptidases that digest both proteins and carbohydrates. So my assumption is that there's general, say, inflammation or infection affecting the small intestine, that both carbohydrate and protein digestion and probably also absorption, including fat absorption in the small intestine, will all be affected. I don't know if there would be a scenario where, you know, literally, I guess actually there would be, maybe from a genetic standpoint, there are certain mutations. One was just characterized last year that seems to predispose to IBS, and it affects one of the particular disaccharidases, which is really interesting to see it that, is. You know, now the information from genomics can also help determine, you know, what may be an optimal diet for an individual.
It is amazing. So the last point here, question was, you were talking about Giardia and it mimicking celiac disease, but it's curious because celiac is really symptoms are lifelong, right? And this would be an acute situation. So how could they think it would be celiac disease when it's acute?
Well, so that's a good question. Actually, we do know that lots of infections, including Giardia, can actually be long-term. And actually reviewed a client case a few months ago where, as far as we know, the individual who had actually some issues with growth as a teenager has likely had Giardia for many, many years, and that's probably what was sort of slowing his overall growth. And probably due to that maldigestion, malabsorption scenario. So that's one, but also Giardia is really well studied as far as a classic example of a pathogen that comes in, does its damage, and then basically is eliminated. But that damage that's left behind, and particularly mostly it's thought to be causing imbalances in the microbiome, that those persist long term. And it's those sort of dysbiosis scenario that certain pathogens cause that then causes these downstream problems. So most likely in many cases with the pathogen, they could be gone after the acute infection, and then they leave behind this scenario that just persists long-term.
Thank you so much. Really, last question. The, on the slide on when you were finishing the case example, which I appreciate so much, pulling this all information all together, when you were with the approach slide, one of the points was address brain gut issues. And you didn't have an opportunity to get into that, and that is likely another whole webinar or two. But could you summarize what you're what you mean about address brain gut issues and how that might influence microbiota?
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of a two-way interaction based on what we know so far. So certainly focusing on the gut can be part of what improves that overall balance between the brain and the gut. But for a lot of patients and clients, a lot of that sort of imbalance can come from the CNS, you know, the brain aspect, and or just the vagus nerve. So we know that overall brain function does influence significantly vagus nerve function, of course. And so patients that have, you know, if they suffer from brain fog, certainly if they have more significant issues like early neurodegeneration, those sorts of things can impact autonomic function. But even just sort of more common things like stress, lack of sleep, especially lack of deep sleep, that's been shown to particularly impact the vagus nerve. So there's a lot of lifestyle factors that actually can improve vagus nerve function. And of course, those who follow clinicians like Datis Karazian, who recommend specific ways to improve vagus nerve function. So there's specific exercises that can be done. Other clinicians actually use devices to stimulate the vagus nerve. So there are various ways to do that. But I think a lot of it comes down to kind of the typical sort of integrative functional medicine type approach is trying to identify in that particular individual, what are their root causes? Do they have a lot of anxiety, stress? You know, that's obviously one of the most common ones, and I see it all the time. Sleep apnea, insomnia, those alone can have a big impact on digestion. Also, circadian rhythm disruption can have a big impact. And, you know, those are all really common sort of things that probably, you know, since they're so common, you know, considering those first would probably be very productive.
Datis does so much on this. And vagus nerve, I mean, just one thing, if we did one thing here out of this is deep breathing with a longer exhalation, with a full inhalation, but an even longer exhalation.
Absolutely.
My goodness, what an effect we could have right now. So let's take
a
collective
there's actually
deep
published
breath right now.
And there's actually published research on that as well, supporting that that definitely has a big impact on promoting vagus nerve function.
True, true. Let's get into that next time. All right, Tom, that's really the last question. I appreciate it very much. And I want to remind everybody that we recorded this and it'll be available on the Hawthorn website under archived webinars in just a few days. There's also a survey to fill out as the webinar ends, and it always helps me to have your feedback. I'd love it if you tell me what you thought of this presentation. And appreciate you taking the time for that. And our next webinar is in December, and it's a two-part presentation on December 3rd and 17th when we host Heather Caprini, who is an emerging expert in, and she'll be presenting on understanding and applying medical cannabis, the art and science. So join us for that. And our next All About Alumni graduate interview is December 6th at 12 noon Pacific time with graduate Amanda Jo Wilt, who's going to be presenting on her postgrad activities, accomplishments, challenges, all of it. We've had so many really good, terrific grad interview presentations, so you can check those out in our webinar archives as well. All right, that ends it for today. I think we've covered everything. Thank you again, Tom Fabian. It was fabulous.
Thanks again, Paula.
I want to thank everybody for sharing this educational experience together. I want to wish you all the best of health and look forward to learning more together at Hawthorne University's webinar series. And until then, I'm going to continue practicing tending my microbiome because what we practice grows stronger. So join me in this too, and I'll meet you back here in a couple weeks. Thanks, everybody.